Hi my dear students, I'm Dr. Jeetu. Today we are going to deal with the chapter Diagnosis, Prognosis and Treatment Plan. The three important chapters have been combined here, but since all the three are short chapters, we'll be dealing with them together, right? Going into the presentation. Okay, so let's see about diagnosis. As we all know, the traditional techniques are always our first hand help, right? So to detect gingival inflammation also, we have to do clinical evaluation. Clinical evaluation of gingiva includes examining for redness, bleeding, suppuration and such features. Then we can also examine for GCF flow. So redness, bleeding, suppuration, all these can be seen with our naked eye, and if it is present, we can say gingiva is inflamed. About GCF flow, we have something called periotron. Periotron 6000 and periotron 8000, two instruments are there. 6000 has high correlation with clinical features. When we determined the amount of GCF with the clinical features, there was a high correlation, but there was inability to measure GCF volume greater than 1 microliter, and that is why periotron 8000 came into being. It has a wider range. Next is subgingival temperature, which is another clinical feature of gingiva. So our instrument is periotemp. Periotemp has physical dimension similar to a conventional probe. It is just like a conventional probe, but when we insert this into the pocket, we can detect a difference of up to 0.1 degree Celsius. So these are for gingivitis. Periotemp, how do we evaluate the result? If the subgingival area has a normal temperature, it is going to give a green color. Intermediate means it is giving yellow color, and if you have elevated temperatures, it is going to give a red color. So as we all know, red indicates danger. So in elevated temperature cases, it is red, and it is an indicator of future periodontal attachment loss. So green is safe, red is danger, means elevated temperatures, and the intermediate area yellow color indicates this. After gingivitis, let's go into periodontitis. Periodontitis means, in simple terms, it is the clinical attachment loss should be there. So to diagnose that, the basic and the simplest instrument is a periodontal probe. Periodontal probe, I think we have already discussed, there are five generations of periodontal probes. First generation is conventional handheld instruments. Example is a Williams graduated periodontal probe. Williams markings are 4 and 6 are missing to highlight the marking 5. Second generation probes are controlled force application ones, or they are pressure sensitive. Third generation ones have a controlled force application plus automated measurement and computerized data capture. So it is computerized. Example is Toronto probe, Florida probe. Second generation probe instrument, if you remember, Vine Valley probe, TPS probe, all these are pressure sensitive probes. Fourth generation probes are three-dimensional probe. We can three-dimensionally get an idea of the pocket around the tooth. And fifth generation probes are true non-invasive probes, meaning to say we are not probing inside the pocket. With the help of the ultrasound device, we are getting to know about the pocket. So the major disadvantage of first generation probe was it was very subjective. Depending upon the pressure given by the operator, or depending upon the probe, the weight of the probe, this penetration of the probe into the pocket was varying. That is why second generation probes came into being, so that we can give controlled force. So there are different forces required for reaching different areas, and these numericals are important. The probing force for a pocket should be 25 grams or 0.75 newtons. This should be the probing force to detect a pocket. And when we are probing inside the pocket, its apical limit is the junctional epithelium. To cross this junctional epithelium, you have to give 30 grams of force. And if you have to reach the bone, you have to give even more force. Up to 50 grams of force should be given. After inserting a periodontal probe into a pocket also, it is very difficult for us to see which marking to record, right? So periovice probes, or periovice premier probes, are a help in this case. They have superior readability and they give faster readings. How is this possible? They are color-coded. So you can just look at the color and you can write your markings. If the green color is not visible, it means up to 3 mm is inside the pocket, and 5 mm is a red colored band. Similarly, 7 to 10 is also a red colored band. After 3, 5, 7, 10 markings, there are probes with 3, 6, 9, 12 markings also, similar to our neighbor's Furcation probe. coming to detection of calculus, conventionally with our visual examination we can detect calculus or sublingual calculus using a explorer and our tactile perception. So there are some diagnostic aids for calculus. The first one is a probe, Kerr probe, which is a probe which detects calculus. So you may get question, what is Kerr probe used for? It is detection of calculus. Another one is detector system. It is for the subgingival diagnosis of calculus. Diagnosis of subgingival calculus. It objectively it detects calculus. Key laser is another system which detects as well as removes the calculus. Detects calculus and also removes calculus. Next is instruments used to detect mobility. Conventionally, how do we do this? Place an instrument or fingers of the physician opposite to the tooth along the buccal aspect as well as the palatal aspect and give force and see whether the tooth is moving, right? More objectively to measure mobility, we have an instrument called periodontometer. Periodontometer detects the mobility of natural tooth, and period test is an instrument which can detect the mobility of natural tooth as well as implant. Again, when we use period test, we are getting some readings. So, what is the conclusion we have to take from these readings? Miller's mobility classification, we all know. Zero is no movement distinguishable. So, this zero corresponds to the period test value of -8 to +9. -8 is the lowest value. To +9 is corresponding to Miller's mobility index zero. Miller's mobility index 1 is first distinguishable sign of movement. The first distinguishable movement is 1. So period test value will be 10 to 19. Then index 2 is the crown will deviate within 1 millimeter of the normal position of the tooth. This can be given a value of 20 to 29. And index 3 or easily noticeable mobility for more than 1 mm in any direction can be given a score of 30 to 50. So -8 to 9, 10 to 19, 20 to 29 and 30 to 50. It ranges from -8 to +50. After mobility, let's see about halitosis. So we all know halitosis is an unpleasant smell of the breath. Our dentures may cause a distinct type of halitosis, and this is known as denture breath. So just be aware that such an entity exists, denture breath. And our hunger period, because of the putrefaction of the pancreatic juices in the stomach, produces a particular odor. It is known as hunger odor. So there is something called denture breath and hunger odor. Then this is a very important question which has been repeatedly asked. There are particular smell for particular medical conditions. Diabetic patients present with an acetone smell or sweet smell or fruity smell. Any of these descriptions applies to diabetic patients. Acetone, sweet or fruity odor. Kidney failure patients also presents with a sweetish odor. So sweetish odor means it is kidney failure. Liver failure presents with the worst smell. It is musty and feculent smell. Feculent means pertaining to feces. So musty and feculent smell. Rheumatic fever patients may show an acid sweet odor. It is not sweet, it is acid sweet. And lung abscess patients presents with a putrefactive odor. Also, we have a probe which can detect halitosis. It is called diamond probe or Perio 2000 system. It is just like a periodontal probe. In addition, it has a sensor which detects the volatile sulfur compound in the periodontal pocket. So, it detects halitosis also. Now there are some drugs causing halitosis. Most important among them are alcohol. We are all aware alcohol has a peculiar smell. Metronidazole tablet has halitosis producing ability. Then disulfiram. Disulfiram is the, we often give it as an alcohol withdrawal drug. And isosorbide dinitrate also produces halitosis. Coming to diagnosis, one is gas chromatography. Gas chromatography technique helps in quantitative analysis of volatile sulfur compounds. So oral chroma is an example. It detects all volatile sulfur compounds, predominantly hydrogen sulfide, dimethyl sulfide and methyl mercaptan. We also have something called halimeter. Halimeter is a portable volatile sulfur monitor. We have seen this alcohol detecting sensors with policemen for testing drink and drive. No, so it's a similar device. It's a portable volatile sulfur monitor. It's an electrochemical sensor and it has high sensitivity to hydrogen sulfide but not the other volatile sulfur compounds. Oral chroma, when it detects all the three volatile sulfur gases separately, halimeter cannot detect like that. Next is the detection of bacteria. കാനറല ഫോർസേത്യ പി ജിഞ്ചിവാലസ് ട്രിപ്പനംബരൻഡിക്കോള ക്യാപ്നോസൈറ്റോഫെഗ ഓൾ ദി സ്പീഷീസ് ഷെയർ എ കോമൺ എൻസൈമാറ്റിക് പ്രൊഫൈൽ ദാറ്റ് ഇസ് ദേ ഓൾ ഹാവ് ട്രിപ്സിൻ ലൈക്ക് എൻസൈം ഇൻ കോമൺ. So by detecting the trypsin like enzyme, we can say that there is the presence of this bacterium. The activity of this enzyme can be measured by the hydrolysis of a colorless substrate, BANA. We all have heard BANA test. What is BANA? N-benzoyl, DL-arginine, 2-naphthylamide. So trypsin like enzyme acts on this BANA to produce a substrate, B-naphthylamide, and this will react with the diazo dye which is impregnated in the test kit, and from the colorless BANA we get a blue color. So colorless to blue is the reaction. So the diagnostic kit developed for this reaction is known as PerioScan. So PerioScan can be used to diagnose the presence of this bacteria, or in other words, the risk of periodontal disease. And it also helps in detecting halitosis, because these bacteria are known to produce volatile sulfur compounds and hence halitosis. So when talking about PerioScan, I want to make one more thing clear. There is an instrument for detecting calculus. We already mentioned a probe called Kerr probe can detect calculus. An instrument called detector can also detect calculus. PerioScan is another instrument which can detect and remove calculus. So if you get a question, what is PerioScan, and both of these are there an option, you have to go for A and B, right? Now about detecting cytokines, there are numerous names which you have to remember. One is PerioGuard. It is not guard, it is guard. PerioGuard detects AST or aspartate aminotransferase. Pocket watch also detects AST, but PerioGuard is a more sensitive method to detect AST levels. Then we have PerioCheck. After perio, it starts with C, right? So it detects for collagenase, you can remember. PerioCheck checks for neutral proteases like collagenases. So how is the test happening? GCF is collected on a filter paper and it is placed in a collagen dye. Then it is labeled with a blue colored dye. When the labeled fragments are produced by neutral collagenase activity in the GCF sample of the patient, then this will release the entrapped blue dye. So again, if you get a blue coloration, then you can confirm the presence of collagenase. Similarly, there is something called BioLyse and Prognostic. These both are tests for detecting elastase enzyme. BioLyse and Prognostic both detects elastase. Another name I want you to remember is TOPAS. TOPAS is the acronym for Toxicity Pre-Screening Assay. It detects increased levels of bacterial toxins as well as increased levels of human inflammatory proteins. Whether it be bacterial or human, it will detect increased toxins or inflammatory proteins. Then we have LAL or Limulus Amebocyte Lysate Assay. This is specific for bacterial endotoxins. What are endotoxins? They are present in the gram-negative bacteria. So, Limulus Amebocyte Lysate Assay is for detecting bacterial endotoxins. Similarly, we have something known as the Epsilomer test. We have all learned about the antibiotic susceptibility test. No, in a petri dish, we'll be putting some culture medium and some areas we'll be putting some antibiotics. So in this area, the bacteria won't be growing, or there will be a clear halo. In other areas, bacteria will be growing. Some test similar to that is Epsilomer test. It's a quantification of the antimicrobial susceptibility of microorganisms. Another advanced method is using of nucleic acid probes. A nucleic acid probe is a molecule of DNA or RNA, any of the nucleic acids, from a specific microorganism, and this nucleic acid probe is artificially synthesized and labeled. Okay. We have developed nucleic acid probes for various organisms like AA, PG, PI and TD, and it is commercially available now. It is being developed and tested, and the commercially available diagnostic methods include DMDx and OmniGene. So what is DMDx and what is OmniGene? They are genomic probes. They are DNA or RNA probes for detecting particular microorganisms. Coming to radiographic techniques, we know conventionally we were using only IOPA or bite-wing radiographs, which we develop then we fix. And later we know RBGs have developed. And there are numerous advancements in radiographic techniques. We will learn the important things from that. One is CT or computer tomography. Here the image is recorded and displayed as a matrix of individual blocks known as voxels. So if someone asks you what is a voxel, it is the matrix of individual blocks you are going to obtain in the computer tomography image. So images that you obtain are recorded as voxels. CT numbers are there. They are known as Hounsfield units. CT numbers range from negative 1000 to positive 1000, each constituting a different level of optical density. So minus 1000 means it is very radio lucent, and a plus 1000 means it is very radio opaque or radio dense. So ranging from minus 1000 to plus 1000, you have Hounsfield units or CT numbers. Now what is CBCT? It is corn beam CT. It is a lower patient dose appliance system when compared to conventional CT. Then we have local CT. Local CT is a type of CBCT. When we have all these CT, CBCT, local CT, and we even use infrared lasers. But if someone asks you what is the best method to assess bone density, it is DEXA. DEXA or dual energy X-ray absorptiometry. The photons in two energy levels are present here. So dual energy X-ray absorptiometry or DEXA. So I think we are done with the advanced diagnostic aids, which are important for us at this point. Moving on to prognosis. Once we diagnose the disease, we can say what is the prognosis. What is the prognosis? It's the prediction of the course or outcome of a disease, predicting how the disease is going to progress. So McGuire and Nunn has given prognosis classes as good, fair, poor, questionable, and hopeless. So if everything is going well, he said it is good prognosis. And if nothing is going to work out for the patient and you're going to extract the tooth, it should be termed as hopeless prognosis. According to Kwok and Caton, there are only four classes. It is favorable, unfavorable, questionable, and hopeless. So either it can be favorable for the treatment or it can be unfavorable. Sometimes we can't decide whether it is favorable or unfavorable, so we call it as questionable. And hopeless is sure shot. It is not going to help and the teeth has to go for extraction. So what I want you to remember in this slide is there is good, fair, poor, there is favorable, there is unfavorable, there is hopeless. All these terms are pertaining to prognosis, but there is no bad prognosis. Okay, so sometimes one of these does not fit into the following category and they can give you a word known as bad. So good prognosis is there, but bad prognosis is not there. The term is poor prognosis. Okay. Prognosis is going to be greatly affected by certain factors. So we are going to learn about those factors. First is risk factor. Risk factors may be environmental, behavioral, or biological factors that when present increases the likelihood of developing the disease. So it can be any factor. It can be environmental, it can be behavioral, it can be biologic. When this factor is present, there is increased risk of the disease. This is called risk factor. Be clear about these terms. Okay, this also has been asked multiple times. Then the next term is risk determinant. Risk determinant, when you hear the word, you have to mark it as a background characteristic. It is a risk factor itself, but it is a risk factor which cannot be modified. Risk factor means smoking is a risk factor. Okay, but when patient, if he wants, he can quit smoking. But risk determinant is not like that. For example, age of the patient. He can do nothing about that. It cannot be modified. The third one is risk predictor or risk marker. Predictors or markers, you have to remember the word association. Predictors or markers are associated with increased risk of disease, but they do not cause the disease. For example, remember bleeding on probing. Bleeding on probing is a predictor of periodontal disease. It is a marker of periodontal disease, meaning to say it is associated with increased risk of periodontal disease. But is bleeding on probing causing periodontal disease? No, it is not the cause of the disease. Finally, risk indicator. Risk indicators are probable or putative risk factors, which is identified in cross-sectional studies, but not confirmed through longitudinal studies. For example, HIV/AIDS. So by cross-sectional studies, we have learned that whichever patient is having AIDS have an increased risk of periodontal disease. But we have never confirmed. We are not following patients with HIV, and we are not waiting for them to develop periodontal disease. So it is never confirmed through longitudinal studies. These factors are called risk indicators. So that's all I want you to remember about prognosis. Now coming to treatment plan. When learning about treatment plan, I want you to remember three terms: immediate goals, intermediate goals, and long-term goals. So when we are formulating a treatment plan, we have an immediate goal, and that is the elimination of infection and inflammation. The patient has come to you with pain, and I want to remove all the infection and inflammation is the immediate goal. What is the intermediate goal? By doing this, I want to reconstruct a healthy dentition, and it should be functional and aesthetic. This is my intermediate goal. But what is my long-term goal? It is the maintenance of this state. I want this elimination of infection. I want the reconstruction of a healthy dentition, but not just for now. I want the maintenance of this through the prevention of the disease and professional supportive therapy. So this is the difference between immediate, intermediate, and long-term goal. This figure has immense importance when we are learning about treatment plan. I know you would have seen this 100 times, but I want you to see this 100 more times. So after the emergency phase, which indicates if there is any acute condition you want to treat, if there is any abscess, you have to drain that. All this comes under emergency phase. After this, you have to go for your non-surgical phase, your scaling and root planing. After you do that, you have to go for the maintenance phase. So after a scaling and root planing, you can't directly go to the restorative phase or to the surgical phase. That is the important thing here. Always put the patient under a maintenance phase. Let the patient come back to you after 2 weeks. Let us see how the patient is maintaining. Let us see his interest. Then you can go for restorative phase, or you can go for surgical phase. And what are these phases named as? The emergency phase is named as, is it phase 1? No, it is not phase 1. The non-surgical phase is the phase 1. Maintenance phase is phase 4. Surgical phase is phase 2. And restorative phase is phase 3. So did you notice one more thing? From the surgical phase, that is phase 2, and from the restorative phase, that is phase 3, again an arrow mark is going back to the phase 4 or the maintenance phase. So after every step you do, the patient has to go on to a maintenance phase. That is the importance of this diagram. Now I'll ask you, root canal comes under which phase? Root canal treatment. In that, we are going and we are invading into the pulp. It is an invasive step, so it comes under surgical therapy actually. And the crown we place after root canal therapy, it is restoring something. So that comes under restorative phase. So don't get confused. Now I told you phase 1 therapy or non-surgical therapy, and I told you scaling and root planing, right? So is that the only procedure that comes under phase 1? No, that is why I put the slide up. Non-surgical therapy includes all these: oral hygiene assessment and education of the patient, supragingival and subgingival scaling and root planing, that definitely all of us know. Extraction of hopeless teeth is coming under non-surgical therapy. Then we have reduction of the local factors. Actually, one more name of non-surgical phase or phase 1 is etiotropic phase. So all the etiological factors will be dealt with in this phase. So reduction of all the local risk factors comes under this phase. Then removal or reshaping of overhanging or over-contoured restorations comes under etiotropic phase. Restoration of the carious lesions, they are also coming under non-surgical therapy or etiotropic phase, because we can't leave behind infections like that. So carious lesions should be excavated and should be restored. Then restoration of open contacts, again it is an etiological factor for the development of disease, so we deal with that also in non-surgical therapy. Now we already mentioned that after every step we have to go to phase 4 or maintenance phase. So how long it should be, what is the duration? For this, Marin has given a classification, Marin's classification. This gives us four group of patients: first year patient, class A, class B, and class C patients. First year patient is a patient who has not completed 1 year. He is within 1 year of his active periodontal therapy. So there can be two type of patients. One is a first year patient who finished routine therapy and has an uneventful healing. When should he be recalled? He can be come back to you after 3 months. Okay. Then another situation is a first year patient who has a difficult case with complicated processes, furcation involvement, poor crown root ratio and a questionable cooperation of the patient. Such a patient has to be recalled every 1 to 2 months. So it is even more difficult case you can expect worse results from the patient. So recall them early, 1 to 2 months is the time duration. So that is about first year patient. First year patient who is good, 3 months. First year patient who has a questionable patient cooperation and questionable parameters, periodontal parameters, 1 to 2 months. Now class A patient. Class A patient means he has completed 1 year after his periodontal therapy, because whichever patient who has not completed 1 year is a first year patient. So whoever has completed 1 year can fall into class A, class B or class C. So class A patient is a patient after 1 year or longer has maintained excellent results. We can recall them in 6 months to 1 year. So what are the characters that a class A patient will exhibit? The patient will display good oral hygiene, minimal calculus, no occlusal problems, no processes, no remaining pockets, and there is no teeth with less than 50%, or at least half of the alveolar support is there for all the teeth. This is a class A patient. You can recall him after 6 months to 1 year. Up to 1 year, if you don't recall the patient also, we expect the patient to maintain the result. So class A patient, 6 months to 1 year. Now class B patient, generally good results maintained for 1 year or more as a class B patient. But there are some problematic factors. These are inconsistent or poor oral hygiene when class A patient had a good oral hygiene. When a class B patient has heavy calculus formation, there are systemic diseases predisposing to periodontal breakdown. Some remaining pockets are there when in class 2 there were no remaining pockets. Complicated processes are there. Patient may be ongoing in orthodontic therapy, recurrent caries. Some teeth with less than 50% support. There were no teeth with less than 50% support in a class A patient. Then smoking and a positive family history. All these are the descriptions of a class B patient. Such a patient should be recalled every 3 to 4 months. Okay, and depending upon the number and severity of the negative factors. Finally, a class C patient is a patient who has generally poor results after periodontal therapy or several negative factors from this list. Inconsistent or poor oral hygiene, heavy calculus formation, systemic disease, many remaining pockets when class B patient was having some remaining pockets. Occlusal problems may be there, complicated processes may be there, recurrent caries may be there. One important feature is periodontal surgery is indicated for that patient, but that patient is not doing surgery for medical, psychological or financial reasons. So he or she is a class C patient. When there are some teeth with less than 50% support in class B, there are many teeth with less than 50% support in class C. Then again, smoking can be there, positive family history can be there, and more than 20% of the pockets bleed on probing. All these make up a class C patient. Such a patient also should be recalled every 1 to 3 months. When we recalled a class B patient at every 3 to 4 months, class C patient should be recalled every 1 to 3 months. I know there are many more things that we didn't discuss because it is a compilation of 3 chapters, diagnosis, prognosis and treatment plan. But most of the important things I have covered. If you have any doubt or if you want elaboration about anything, please feel free to contact me. Thank you.